hand you the mic.
As you see, the teams are on ice here as we are getting to the nitty-gritty final two draws here today. And this is draw number six of the 2018 Nova Scotia Scotties Tournament of Hearts here on Bell 5 TV 1. We're featuring the 0-5 Team Ladislaur out of the Lakeshore Curling Club taking on the 4-1 Marion Arsenault team out of the Dartmouth Curling Club. My name's Dan Hobbs, and joined alongside here by Pam Sullivan. And right now, of course, Arsenault sitting pretty good position. 4-1, second place, and hoping to maybe punch her ticket to get into those playoff rounds. So let's get your thoughts on this one as we have our first throw on its way from their lead, Elsa Noss, out of Team Ladislaur.
I definitely think that the Arsenault team is looking to finish this morning with a win. I mean, as you say, it would definitely get them into the finals, which is where they're hoping to go. And I think by the same token, Ladislaur will be looking for their first win. And it's a junior team. I know the team fairly well. Some of my kids have curled against her in the past. And, you know, she's a very positive player, and I'd really like to see this game go today.
Yep, so as you mentioned, Arsenault 4-1, second place. McDermott is 5-0, Brothers 3-2. And then everybody else is has a losing record. Breen 2-3, Jones 2-3, McAvoy and Pinckney 2-3, and Ladislaur 0-5. So Brothers, Arsenault, McDermott hoping to break away from the rest of the pack and, you know, clinch themselves into the semis for tomorrow and try to get into that final on Sunday. So.
And yep. that group at 2-3 are certainly looking for some wins today as well.
And hoping for a little bit of help, hoping that maybe the three, I guess you could say the three front runners come back to them.
Yes, exactly.
Yep, so.
They're looking to win and have the other teams lose.
Yep, so of course, update games on CD, Breen 2-3 versus the 5-0 McDermott. So basically, Breen is trying to be a giant killer and bring McDermott her first loss here at the championships in a battle of 2-3. So between Jones and Pinckney, Delhunt Pinckney, whichever you want to refer to it as, 2-3 there. So one of them will be going down to a fourth loss. And Julie McAvoy is going to try to be even with Brothers if she can get a victory. McAvoy 2-3 versus 3-2 Brothers. So a win by McAvoy will even her with Brothers 3-3 and make her chances improve, and Brothers drop down to 3-3, so could almost be like one of those tiebreaker situations.
Yeah, it'll be fun to see how it sorts out.
Yep.
Teams have been really close. I mean, it's nice to see a lot of teams grouped together from the spectator point of view. It means that oftentimes there's a lot of close games that are interesting to watch.
And, of course, for our producer, Sean, Arsenault has the hammer here and in number one, and Arsenault is throwing the blue stones. And we'll pass that information on to you long as well. So expect a quiet start, probably, Pam, or maybe there'll be what we saw yesterday in the men's. All of a sudden, there was a lot of offense early. What are you expecting here out of the teams in this first in, maybe?
I haven't seen these teams play this year, so I can't really predict what their approach will be in this early in. But in general, I think everybody likes to try to find their feet.
Yep.
So it's fairly open at this point, and it'll be interesting to see. Looks like Arsenault is calling for the draw behind the yellow and the blue dart there.
Yep, so of course we'll run down the teams as we see the throw here from the Arsenault foursome. Jennifer Gross is lead, second Jennifer Baxter in your pitcher now. Third, Christina Black and skip Marion Arsenault. They're coached by Peter Corbin. Corkum. Their fifth is Carol McLean out of the Dartmouth Curling Club, and they're probably the second hottest team right now. McDermott, of course, the first hottest, going 5-0, but since that first loss to start the championships, they have gone four straight, hoping to go five after this one. As we take a look at Isabel Ladislaur and have a little bit of a change in their lineup, Pam, due to class reasons. They have had to switch their lineup. Elson Noss is the lead. Second is Michaela Harnish. There is Michaela Harnish. And Emily Pruel is allowed to get in and play third here. And Isabel out of Sur is a skip. And their coach, Brian Rayfuse, out of the Lakeshore Curling Club. So sometimes, of course, with a young team, the exams and classes prevent them to try to get into playing. And that's the situation here for them today. Here is Harnish.
Is that not the team that was in the brochure that we have, the way it's listed?
Yeah, that's it. Okay. You know, just they've had to basically, you know, make that change. Was the change that they had previously. So they do a lot of changes on that team. So
they do. I would call this their Canada Winter Games team.
Yeah.
So this is the team that they're taking to the Canada Winter Games playdowns in March. So this team is looking to go forward in that championship, of course, if they can. So all of these gals would be 17 or under at this point.
Yep, they are, as people have probably seen or probably heard in the media, the sweethearts, the young guns here in this championship, the youngest ever to qualify here. Definitely having a little bit of a tough time going 0-5, hoping they can probably try to get off the snide here, but it's not going to be easy here because that is
a great sweep there.
Experienced team that they are facing here this morning.
Yes, absolutely, and it's great experience for these girls as they play against the older teams, not even that they're older, but just more experienced teams, and I think they probably see a little bit of different strategy and sort of a much more experience when it comes to calling of the angles and those more precise shots, for sure.
So here's Emily Pruel. And not much laid a brush on it here by Noss and Harnish.
And I think Isabel and Emily have played together for quite a long time. They're sort of the It seems to me, from my viewpoint, they seem to be the core of the team, as other players maybe age out of different divisions or whatever, but I feel like those two have been through thick and thin together.
Sheet a little bit tilted, as we see all kinds of rocks on one side and one lonely one in the back on the other, so.
Yeah, there's a lot more weight on that one side, that's for sure.
Christina Black, throw on its way here in number one.
And Jennifer Baxter working on that, trying to keep it straight. I think that's her. Yeah. That's a great little hit, a little flop in behind that really lines up nicely now. Isabel has chosen to draw. And I think that's behind tee line down there, which makes it a nice little spot to nestle into.
Emily Pruel here out of the Lakeshore Curling Club. Out there on its own, now starting to come over.
Yeah, that's not really finishing yet the way they had hoped. Trying to encourage it to roll in there. Maybe just a wee bit heavier than what they thought, so it stayed a little straighter, a little longer. They got a little bit of a bump there, and looks like that yellow is open for the Arsenault team to knock it out.
As you see, the broom already down, and you said pretty well open. Easy for Christina Black to make a play on it. And Baxter on the brush already.
Looks like it's lining up really nice. Probably get a little flop in, or will it be a nose? A little flop in.
Yeah, a little flop.
Very nice.
Sitting two already. Sitting two in the 4 foot and the 8 foot area here as our snow team has pressure here on this young team. As Isabel Latticer makes her way up here for the skip rocks here in number one.
So I think she's going to look to hit on this shot where that rock is left partially open. I really think she would like to stick one in the house here somewhere, make it a little more difficult for the Arsenault team to finish up the end.
Yeah, And as you can see, that she's a left-handed curler, so. Of course, we see a lot of right-handers, so what is the right-hander's in turn is their out turn, so it's the opposite for a left-hander, and she's all over that yellow one.
I see the both teams are looking at the ice and whatnot. There seems to have been some kind of a pick out there, maybe under the slider of Isabel. I'm not quite sure. So although she didn't get the shot rock that she was looking for there, she did push it. It's a little more open, so that's kind of a plan B there.
Yep. Kind of usually have to have plan Bs. Sometimes the A's don't seem to go the way that you think or plan, so.
I need C's, D's, and E's when I play.
I'll follow you up on that. I go all the way from G to Z, so, I mean. A, don't fall down when you pull out of the hack. B, don't throw it over onto the other sheet. C, don't fall head first.
There's certainly lots of ways for things to go wrong.
I say this jokingly, but it happened yesterday. D, don't throw the wrong color.
Oh, yes, no.
DC Power game, all of a sudden, we're looking, have weird looks on our faces. One of the DC players picks up the yellow stone. He was blue and threw it down. It's like, I think they threw the wrong stone. So
that's not all that uncommon, certainly in the junior ranks where I spend most of my time. But sometimes you get so focused on the shot, you grab your favorite color instead of the color that you're throwing.
Blocks and that one that's in the 4 foot area.
Sure does. Closes the hit right out of there, forcing Isabel to come in for a draw. The ice doesn't seem to be curling and finishing a lot as the rock slows down. It'll be interesting to see if she can nestle in behind there.
So as we have sort of seen, some ends start off very quiet, but as you see, there's plenty of stones here in play here in this first end, and the Arsenal team taking it here to the young guns and applying the pressure early, and right now they have 2 in the 4 and the 8 foot area, and that's what's facing Lattisser and her last rock here in 1. They're working on it, but it's
that's really hanging out there.
Yeah, it's well
there.
Out there, yeah.
And it's a bit early as well in terms of sorting out the exact weight that the ice will be and so on.
Well, there was a couple of there's 2 stones there that is in the 12-foot area, so at least it will probably, definitely for sure cancel out one of those blue ones there, so. But can leave a draw here for 3 here for Arsenal here and in number 1 with Hammer.
It looks to me like she's calling the hit on the yellow back in the back 8 foot there for 3, for 4 potentially if she sticks.
Yeah.
If you had the overhead view, you could see that getting rid of that rock would be very beneficial to the Arsenal team. There we go.
Yeah, get a look at it, and we're wondering which one was closer, and get a chance to look at it.
Exactly.
Definitely the blue, so.
Easier to see there now. If she eliminates this and sticks, she'll get 4 in this end, which would be a terrific start for her.
Final stone on its way here by the Dartmouth Curling Clubs. Marion Arsenault sitting 3 right now, wanting to remove that yellow in the back for 4.
Sweeper doing a big scrub there. This looks great, though. Hit and stick. Lovely
there it
shot.
Is. 4 to start.
So certainly the Arsenault team had their end plan fulfilled there. Get at least 2 with Hammer, and they have 2 plus 2 more, so that's a great start for them.
4-0, and sometimes it's not how you start, how you finish. Like after that,
we've seen that.
5-4 loss to McDermott, and then since then, like 4 straight wins, and just been like solid from one end right to the other, just continuing solid play, and basically she can win pretty well you know, control her own future and not even have to worry about the rest of the pack. Sitting at second place, 4-1, and definitely maybe hoping for Breen here to defeat McDermott, who's at 5-0, and then have a tie for first. But basically, they're taking care of business on their own sheet, and whatever happens on the other sheet is what happens, happens.
That's right. Not much they can do to influence that today.
Yeah.
So we have a Ledoux here. We'll have the hammer in this end.
And she'll have some catching up to do down by four as we are into end number two. Ladisher with the yellow stones. Has hammer here in this end.
So Jennifer Cross looks like she's going in with her first here. And we'll sit right on the button. Very nice shot. And of course,
Ladisher needs rocks. We'll just...
Yep, she'll put up a corner guard here, I think. I didn't see her. It looked to me like she called for the corner guard, but certainly I would expect that to be the strategic move here.
Here's Elsa Noss. As we mentioned, this new team having a little bit of a difficult time in their championships. 0-5, started off with a loss to Jill Brothers and lost to Teresa Breen, McDermott, Pinckney, and McAvoy. But Brian Rayfew's pretty happy about the way the team has played overall here at the championships, and maybe the record doesn't quite, you know, really speak of how well they've sort of played, and they've given teams some difficulty, and, you know, they've had some fights, they've had some close ones. They almost, have pulled out a victory, and it's just with one bad end, and, you know, easily could be, 1-4 or 2-3.
Yeah, no, that's right, and I mean... Yeah, this is great experience for the girls. And you don't see, the 5-0 doesn't tell you what happened in every game.
Yeah, exactly.
You know? Yeah, exactly.
Well, sometimes it's like in this sport, it can only be like one end, you're solid for nine, but all of a sudden you have one bad end and
Kaboom.
The other team puts a 3 or 4 or 5 on it, and there you go. So yeah. As we thought would happen, both the Arsenault Stones in the house. And they're going to be ignored here as Noss will be asked to put up another guard. I got the strategy as soon as the team scores a big number, like right the next in, you know, they put it in the house. Next skip ignores it. Another one in the house.
Yep.
Another corner guard. Then they peel the guard.
And then the mess starts.
And then when the mess starts, it's like, I just almost want to pick up my suitcase. Yeah, you guys deal with this. I got to go.
So she didn't end up with a corner guard here. I'm not entirely sure what the call was, but it's in the house. She gave a little bump to the second rock. We'll see what happens here. Of course, as predicted, the Arsenault team will want to keep this clean where they're up by four, so... She's looking to eliminate that corner guard so that Isabel's team has nothing to hide behind.
Peels the guard and shooter goes out of play as well. So as you see, that definitely, of course, on that second one there by Noss, a miss because they would have had to, you know, on their next one, peel that one. Now they have options here and nothing in front of the house. So as you see right there, that shot. You also see the standings there in the back. Of course, there's a little bit of the wall blocking it. And you see McDermott and Arsenault up top there, 5-0 and 4-1, respectively. Some brothers there, 3-2.
So she's looking to put up the guard that was just removed.
This is Michaela Harnish of hers here in second.
It's pretty well going to land right where the broom was sitting, so I think that's a shot well made. Very good. Now it's back pretty much in the same spot as the first one. They had no trouble peeling it. I would think that we'll see that same thing here.
Kara Baxter.
One sweep around here looking to peel away, and it's well made again.
Yeah, seen a lot of this yesterday in their game against Brothers. It was funny after the game, some of, of course, the fans were clearing out, and the Brothers team were having their little meeting afterwards. And Jill was talking to a person, and she was saying a lot about picks, and it was kind of hurting their rocks, and it just allowed the Arsenal team to break away, and then they were just basically playing the game right now. They're doing just, you know, guards were put up, appeals were made, so they're used to this. They've had a lot of practice at it. So.
And a team with the experience and the skill of the Arsenal team, they can make those hits over and over and over again. So it's it feels a bit difficult as the other team to try to set something up.
Yeah, it was just a one-point difference in that game versus McDermott to in their first draw. So, I mean, easily they could be 5-0.
I think McDermott ended up with a three-pointer in that final end to get the one-point win, actually.
Yeah,
so that must have been a very close game.
Yeah, so as we were saying, one in just separates the difference, whether you're like 4-1, 5-0, or even 0-5. So.
Yeah. And curling's a tough old game. You can make your shot almost perfect, but if it isn't perfect, you've exposed yourself in some way. And certainly, certainly teams will look at those opportunities.
Yeah, well, I had the, Greg Power Mark Dacey game last night, and they shook hands early in that one. 8-3 was the final, but sometimes, Power was, making these, real tough shots there to. The score could have been even worse, but he was making great shots, but it just. You know, you say half a shot miss, and
And oftentimes, if your skip is left with a very difficult great shot, it means there's been little bits throughout the end where the other team has been higher on the percents. You know, they've made their shots precisely. So we have a little change up here. We have the ring split, which is kind of nice.
Two in the 4 foot area, and want to remove that top one in the rings. Put in the hands of Christina Black here as we are into the third stones in two.
Just clean on this, unless the sweepers and the skip must like the line. That's a great shot.
Yeah, a hit and a roll, and
partially covering the shot stones in the 4 foot there. Actually, they're sitting three now, actually, so. A wee bit of chatter there between the skip and mate on Le Dossier, and that's always very good to see. It's important that everybody gets on the same page before the shots are thrown, and that bit of communication can just make the difference in a shot.
Emily Prue with some upweight here in two.
Looking to move some granite out of that house.
Just punches out one.
And rolls away.
Arsenal lies too, about hammer into.
She had a lot, that was a bit of a rocket. That one had a lot of power behind it.
There's some of these young teams, Lattiser, we talked about the youngest here at the Scotties Tournament of Hearts. The Greg Power team in the men's division, also pretty young. Their oldest member is Greg the Skip at 32, so they have a lot of 21s and 22s.
And I think they're even maybe an 18-year-old on that team.
18-year-old Graham Weigel filling in for Alex Rayfuse. He can throw some cannons. He was throwing some missiles last night.
I bet.
I'd like to almost have the old baseball radar gun and just see how fast it was going.
Of course, the curlers would use a stopwatch for that and measure the time between the hogs, or potentially the time from the back line to the hog line as you're coming out. It's typically fairly important to know what weight your thrower is throwing so that you can choose the ice appropriately. If somebody's playing, you'll see the skips point to, say, the hack or the board or something like that, and that's a specific weight, a speed of rock that they're looking for. And then they ice the shot accordingly. So if your player throws a rocket and you're only expecting hack weight, you're not going to make that shot.
Arsenault, for a previous throw, did remove the yellow stone belonging to Lattiser. Couldn't keep the shooter, so they'll lie to here.
So at this point, it's bailout time. She's looking for the double here and a hopeful blank on the end, I would say.
See what type of weight that she could throw here. Lattisher here in two. Harnish, Noss on, and now they're off.
It's typically a good sign.
Bangs and just punches one of the blues out and loses a shooter, but a blue one sticks around there, so. 1 point they were lying three, but now they lie one, but Arsenal will make her way up the ice here and can change that situation here for Last Rock here in two. Definitely want to put this in the spot to make Lattisher not have a double. Hey, baby, we're forced to one.
Or even the steal from Arsenal's point of view. If she covers this up nicely, it's going to be a very tough draw. So she's looking for a tight guard in the center line. Rock slowing down and curling there now. Looks pretty good.
The Jennifer's Kraus and Baxter.
Really working it to get the proper line here. And she's got about half of that rock covered. So this makes the hit, if she was trying to hit, challenging.
I know it's only early, Pam, just a second in, but it is a big one here.
It certainly is. Yeah. Team Lattisher will be looking to change the momentum here, I think.
Trailing five after two, or only trailing three after two. So it's a 2 point swing here with one stone, and it's on its way from Lattisher and two.
Needs to curl in a little bit here if it's going to stay around, but I suspect she's hoping for the. Yep.
Yeah,
she got her blank and carry on to the next end with in play for two.
Of course, the blank also there too, as you mentioned there. So the first blank of the game as we head to three.
I would say that the Lattisher team would call that a success. If you're not getting your two and you get the blank, that's the very next best thing when you have hammer. So I would think they should be very pleased with that end.
So we head to in number three, still 4-0 Arsenal. Lattisher will have the hammer and she's throwing the yellow stones.
Our game is ahead of everybody else, but we can say that Brothers versus McAvoy, they put up a blank in their first end. And Pinckney scored two over Team Jones. And it looks like McDermott scored one over Breen in the first end.
Thank you, Pam, for those updates. Of course, that Pinckney-Jones, both of those teams, even records of 2-3, trying to prevent that fourth loss. Fourth loss will pretty well do it for sure. And right now, it's McAvoy, Pinckney, and Jones, and Breen on the bubble. But as I say, everything's going to be clear. You said this off air before we went on. Everything will be clear by the time the day is done.
Absolutely.
Where everybody will sit, so.
Thank you.
So that first one didn't come in quite as deep as we saw in the last end. Doesn't faze Isabel, though. She's going to put up a corner guard.
You had a chance to see it because you were coaching Team Gray at the Junior Championships. This team, Isabel Lattisher at the Lakeshore Curling Club, they went 1-3 in their own championships that they sort of hosted. And we talked about how they were the youngest ever to qualify for the Scotties. And they have done a little bit of World Curling Tour games. with a record of 4-5, and you know, it's basically you know, trial by fire. You're not going to get a chance to play with to play with the elite. You have to play with the elite. You may not get the results that you want, but eventually you use that experience and you're going to learn and grow from it.
Absolutely. And you know, curling, we see a lot of the same teams, whether it's in the ladies division or in the U21s, U18s, you'll see a lot of the same teams in a small area like Nova Scotia. So it certainly expands, I guess, your experience when you play up against stronger teams or different teams than are typically in your age group. It doesn't take very long before you start to see you can't count on a miss from the other team to help you out.
Yeah. So Elsa Noss here with her second, the lead stone for this team of the Lakeshore Curling Club. Lattiser was going to come out. Now she's pointing where she wants it. So then now Harnish and Prue give a little scrubbing there. So it's a long guard. And they're just going to get that off the center line.
Again, the Arsenault team not looking to leave anything to hide behind.
Yep.
Oh, that's a great little peel. You see the sweeper working to get it right out to the edge, so there's absolutely nothing out in front.
Yeah, they weren't really able to use the, you know, take advantage of that free guard zone to see things empty once again, just like the previous end, so deja vu all over again as we play three.
The Arsenault team is very precise with these hits. They're making it look easy this morning.
Well, they say they're just cooking with gas right now.
Mm-hmm.
You know, just
those
no real flaws of their game. It just you know, no holes, no flaws, and they get a lead. It's tough for the opposition to come back, whether a young team like Lattiser or some of the veteran teams that are already here.
And those open hits certainly look easy, but, you know, even if you might make a hit and not roll away and leave something for the opponent, so the precision here is great this morning.
The yellow one goes up, and Skipper asking the yellow one to disappear. And we'll be asking Baxter to remove it.
We get a great view of the slides. These girls are so solid. Jennifer Baxter looked like an arrow pointing out of the hack there on that one, sliding down.
And just like the previous one, out it goes again. Thing you got to really like is the maturity of this team. They are young but haven't shown a lot of frustration, and you know, in pregame and stuff you still see them smile, and you know, they're happy to be here. But of course, you know, teams say, well, we just didn't come just to, you know, be here. They want to do very well and compete, and
yep.
You got to like it, you know, 0-5, you know, they just pretty well forget about the record, don't even look at it, and just concentrate on your game. It's pretty well all you can do, and the result is what the result is.
That's right. And I don't know the team extremely well, but I've seen them on the ice, and you see a lot of very positive interactions between these team members. Throughout a game, Isabel doesn't appear to get frustrated. She tends to be very positive and often flashes a smile, irrelevant of the score, you know? So I think they're probably developing their sports psychology, and it's just really one shot at a time and one game at a time.
Takes out the yellow, and the blue goes back a little bit more there, just in the 8-foot area. Still being ignored by Lattiser. Another guard gonna be on its way.
Really tough to build up any points. those initial two guard stones are so very important with a good hitting team like the Arsenal team. And proper placement is really, really critical.
Emily Pruel.
Sweepers were on and now off, just waiting for this to settle in the right spot. Certainly nicely lined up. I think they'd like it, in some ways, the closer it is to that blue rock, the tougher it'll be to remove.
Christina Black. Baxter sweeping all by herself. And easily picks that out.
Yep. They've got these peels nailed.
They've been pretty well in this mode since didn't get a chance to see the first game, but they've been pretty well in this mode since the second.
Okay.
Their second draw. Just get a big score and then defend.
Mm-hmm. And I would guess if they had the hammer back, they would still be trying to pick up two more, that's for sure.
Mm-hmm.
This one looks like it has a little more weight than the last one, just looking at the body language of the sweepers.
Yeah, that may go a little bit deep and deeper than maybe what they like. It's curling now and come to a stop, so.
Settles in a decent spot and not that different than the last one. It's just off screen, but directly, there we go. Lined up very nicely with the blue in behind. So again, they need a peel to spill that out of there. Of course, Isabel and her team are looking for a jam.
Yeah.
That's what they would like, a nose hit and that to be jammed on into the host.
Well, it's a trial by fire here for Pruel. She, the championships wasn't with the team, so I'm not sure when she joined because they've had a shifting lineup as we talked about.
Oh,
so
she didn't play in the championships, eh?
Oh, she didn't start here the championships on the first day, so the.
Excuse me.
Not sure if she had a chance to do anything on the practice day on Monday. So.
Okay.
But I'm sure any information during the after game meetings that they have, they probably transferred on to her and knows about the ice conditions. So.
Mm-hmm. And as much as the ice conditions, you can talk about them and share them every day, has a wee bit of a surprise in it. You never know what you might see that could be different,
yeah,
especially with the changing weather.
You nailed that one because things are starting to warm up. They're going to be double-digit warm, whether it's 10, 13 degrees possibly tomorrow.
That'll be nice in some respects, but I understand it's accompanied with a big load of rain, so we'll be swimming our way home maybe.
Yep. Wearing them water wings and shorts.
So a wee change of plans here. Instead of out front, they've elected to hit and stay in the house and see if they can generate something that way.
I guess that what we're getting is that little bit of what they call the January thaw, so.
It's always much appreciated by us in Nova Scotia, I think.
Yeah, Christmas was cold and junior championships, I know that must have been chilly going back and forth, going to the rink and leaving the rink and going in the cold. And
you want to make sure the car is heated up before you get into it, that's for sure.
I'm sure you had a lot of help with some people that you told them, warm up the car for me. I'm going to the rink. Warm up the car for me. Whether it was a husband, kids.
It kind of depends what time the draw is. If it's early, then that's on me.
We'll just have to work on that.
I know. I've done something wrong. Yeah.
Can you get some of the boys on your junior team to, hey, you have to go for a morning run. Come by my place, start the car. Be greatly appreciated.
That's right. So I think Isabel will be looking for the hit and roll away as we look at another blank possibility.
How goes it? Excellent.
Yeah, pretty well. Just remove the blue stone and hopefully get rid of the yellow as well. Final stone, Lattiser in three.
Hit and roll away. As predicted, we have another blank.
Back to black blanks as we head to the fourth.
Yeah. Remaining at 4-0 after three. In favor of Arsenal.
Yeah, McDermott Breen 1-1 tie there. Still Pinckney 1-0 or 2-0. McAvoy's got two on Brothers, so 2-0, and that's the latest updates in those ones. Team's having a little bit of meetings. You see in the corner is, this is Jennifer Kroos, the 37-year-old, two national Scotties appearances, two national mixed appearances, works for Canada Life as a regional sales manager. The lead here on this Arsenal team out of the Dartmouth Chronicle up 4-0 as we play in number four. Alongside Pam Sullivan, my name is Dan Hobson, the Bell 5 TV One crew. Producer Sean Senatol, gladly here on this Friday morning. Happy Friday, all. Hope it's a good one. Getting down to the nitty-gritty here at the Nova Scotia Scotties Tournament of Hearts. And later on, we're going to have two men's draws as well. So, final day of the round-robin portion.
I would think by this time of the week, I know all these folks out here are in great shape and certainly trained for all of this, but I would think after playing the numbers of games and the length of games that they've played this week, they'd all be pretty tuckered out at this point.
Well, yeah, the ladies had like two on Tuesday, two on Wednesday. Yesterday had just one draw, and then back to another two for them. That's a lot of games in a short amount of time. And I know everybody says, well, you know, in the nationals, have three draws a day. But I mean, the thing is, too, is that you have like 11, 12 teams. So there's some teams that do have like a bye or have the morning, afternoon, or the evening off. So
right. I don't think
there's none here. Like,
yeah, I don't think they can do more than two a day. I think that's kind of a rule. So Team Arsenal setting up in a very familiar pattern. We've seen this in prior ends.
Yeah, we've seen this movie. The only thing we're forgetting is the popcorn and the nachos and the salsa here on a Friday morning. And everybody says, well, that may be a little bit early for that. But definitely seems like, the same movie, same shot time after time. But you get up by four, you know, this is pretty well defend mode. And, you know.
On this end, we've got the two corner guards set up in the locations that the team has looked for, so that will certainly start to put things in a better place for the Lattiser team. In this kind of a scenario where the guards are fairly flat, they're looking to peel one out for sure.
There's Jennifer Baxter, a 30-year-old, 10 Scotties Provincials, two appearances at the Scotties Nationals.
What a nice shot.
Learning Center resource teacher at Elizabeth Sutherland School. And once again, lying to is Arsenal here as we play on and in number four. We're at the halfway point of this one as we're into second stones. For Michaela Harnish here. And there she is. I have a funny feeling one of her favorite colors is pink, because she has pink gloves and a pink broom handle.
Yep, she's color coordinated. I'm thinking you're right with the pink.
Noticed the pink gloves, but then I took a closer look. The broom's pink, too.
Mm-hmm.
And it looks like the Noss and Prue have, like, pink on their brushes on the bottom, so.
Bit of a theme going on.
Yeah, that looks like they have pink and black, so maybe they're called the Pink and Black Attack. I don't know. Maybe it's what their nickname is.
So I think that last one, they might have liked to have come in behind and nestled between those two blues, but just had a wee little rub off, giving a nice clean hit available for the Arsenal team.
Yeah, not wasting any time. They removed that yellow one from harness just like that, so saving some time for sure they are. Green just got a single point there, so it's 2-1 as they play in four over McDermott. Just posted. Colleen Pinckney 3 and Nancy Delahunt 2 as they play four. Brothers on the board, 2-1 as they play four. Brothers in McAvoy on sheet B.
So a wee bit of a tap back there. That gives yellow second shot. With a wee bit of luck, of course, with a wee bit of luck, they might get a jam out of that, but I suspect Team Arsenal will spill that out of there very nicely. It's just coming over now. It looks really good.
Yep, punches that out and
another clean peel.
Sweepers, Baxter and Kroos, the two Jennifers as I call them, just went along for the walk with the rock and weren't needed on that one. As Black did it all by herself.
So Emily is looking to draw in behind that very long blue guard.
And we're getting to the closing stages here of in number four, so.
This is the time to start getting some rocks in that house for Team Ladasur.
Time for business to pick up here for the Ladasur team. Down by a four spot here in four.
Boy, the girls have to give this a big scrub to get it in where they want.
And he's gonna come up short.
Mm-hmm.
Now.
Looks like a wee bit of discussion whether they'll run the guard out in front. Yep, that's where they've gone. It looked to me like there was a wee bit of hesitation. They thought they might put another one in. But
yeah, well, they were getting ready just to, you know, get ready for that come around, as you say, and then mm-hmm. came up short. So then it's just all of a sudden you may have to take a couple of deep breaths. I've heard a lot of them say about, you know, focus on your shot and picture your shot. And then all of a sudden the shot doesn't go because they don't make it. So then you have, well, now I have to picture this shot, so mm-hmm. And then, of course, as you said, the discussion, too. So they remove it, and there you see, two blue behind the tee line, belonging to Arsenal.
And same call for Emily. She's looking to draw in. So I expect we'll see a little more weight on this shot.
Yeah, and you see a lot more weight.
Sweepers are keeping a watchful eye.
Yeah, they get on it. Noss and Harnish.
On and off. This looks like we may be tapping the one in the back of the four.
Maybe a plan B, tap and push back.
That's a pretty good plan B.
Yeah. Shot rock momentarily belonging to the Ladasur team and the Lakeshore Grilling Club. Ladasur does have the hammer here at four.
Looks to me, instead of a peel, that Marianne Arsenault is looking for a hit and roll. Play for the steal at this point. If she can roll in behind that blue rock that you see out in front of the house, she has a real good chance of a steal.
Such a fine line, like between like defending and then, you know, you still want to continue to like the play the aggressive style, but not get into a situation where all of a sudden you're in over your head and you're allowing your opposition to come back. It's such a real fine line. Because, I mean, as we talked about, like two games a day for these ladies, except for yesterday when they only had one. So, I mean, you know that you're going to be in situations where there's going to be a lot more rocks in play the closer you get to, like, the semis and the finals and everything. So
yep, that's right. They're starting to curl here now. Sweeper keeping it clean. And
punches the blues and the yellows to sit there right on the lid. Through Latasore, as you see, Latasore was just on the top of your screen, now out of it.
All smiles out there by the hog line, looking at her shot coming up.
Yeah.
I suspect they're going to look for the hit and roll here. Again, try to get behind that lone blue guard that's out in front of the house. Make it a challenge for Team Arsenault to either remove or get a better counter that's well hidden.
I think, of course, sometimes also that, you know, coaches have had a chance to, while the other game's going on, scout the other teams. The thing with the Latasore team, if you're going to get to them early, because all of a sudden you get to the second half of this one, that comes a little different.
Exactly. Here we go with the shot. And she's going to roll a bit on the open side. So it does change up the path, which is a good thing. The ice is very well known in that other hit area. So she does switch up the shot for Marianne.
Well, the things you see here in the broadcast location that, you know, people can't see back at home is just phenomenal. Carol McLean with her biggest fan.
We're all enjoying the benefits of her biggest fan.
I'm going to pay for that. I know I am. The fifth in break, if I'm not back, you better start calling some authorities.
There comes Marianne Arsenault with her final in this end. Sweepers on and off, just giving it a peek, a little clean here and there, which is always good. You don't want to pick up any picks and a hit and roll to the outside 12 foot, which is very nice. Present a good challenge for Isabel, who will look for another blank.
It's awesome.
See, I asked for that. I say it kiddingly, my friend.
Those fans can be swung many different ways,
yes.
Right?
Yes.
Got nice little flowers on it. I thought it might have had little curling rocks. Of course, she's the fifth, and she also got a little tablet there, keeping track of things. Peter Corcoran right next to her. Definitely having a fantastic championships here. Looking for their fifth win in a row.
Sweepers looking to keep this straight so we get the roll away.
Can they roll away?
They do. Another successful end. Not in terms of a score for the Latasore team, but again, it's the next best thing, I think.
Yeah, all the offense, all the points, game in that first end as we head to end number five, still 4-0 for Arsenault over Latasore. Dartmouth Curling Club leading the Lakeshore Curling Club as we head to end number five. So people just tuned in. Blanks in 2, 3, and 4. And, of course, Arsenault with hammer took advantage. Put a big four spot on. And that's where we stand as we head in number five. Of course, this T-Barcido, we talked about Christina Black, originally from Cape Breton, and you know, Marion Arsenault, 20 appearances here at this event.
So. She's looking very relaxed in the skip position at the other end, waiting for that rock to land exactly where she wanted it.
Yeah, so people saying, well, this is what has happened. Like, you get that 4-0 lead, and you know, they don't want rocks in play, keep things clean. And I was like amazed at the junior championships, like that Caitlin Jones team, like in the sixth in, got a lead and she pretty well cruised it on home. 7th, 8th, 9th, and pretty well blanked it from the rest of it. You just don't often see that, but three straight blanks used to be what used to be done in the before the free guard zone, and seen it a lot. But not as frequent.
No, not as frequent. And I think next year they're looking at a 5-rock rule instead of a 4-rock rule, which will make those blanks all that more, much more difficult. These open ends might be a little bit more difficult to get in play.
It's funny how it has evolved. It went started at a 3 and then went to a 4. Now they're talking 5.
And once upon a time, there was no free guard zone.
Yeah, exactly. And that's when the days I could have done very well. I was interested in doing it once they, you know, had that because they had my plan. Look, get the hammer in one and hold on to it to the 10th, draw the button, 1-0. And then Russ Howard had to come up with an idea, and everybody has done very well with it. And I have gone to being just a curling commentator.
Well, and it makes it more interesting, though, certainly from the fan perspective and also from the strategic side, just as a skip or a player trying to figure out how to generate those points. Looking at the double corner guard again. The first one is nice and tight to the house. Of course, they'd like to get those flat to prevent that double that we saw last end. I don't think there's a double there.
Don't think the free guard zone inventing it by Russ Howard is what really got a street named after him, but she originally curled out of Ontario and then moved to New Brunswick, and of course was with Brad Gushue at the Olympics. And now you see him commentating for curling. Punch the yellow and move the blue over.
So this opens up maybe a wee bit of an opportunity for Team Ladasur. They still have a guard in play. And she's looking to hit and roll behind cover here.
Game coming up to its 1 hour mark, just a minute shy of it. So in the fifth in, cruising right along here on this Friday morning. Draw 6, Nova Scotia Scotties Tournament of Hearts. Kayla Harnish being asked for the hit and roll, as my broadcast colleague has documented.
This hit and roll will be to the outside. It's playing a quiet weight here. It's more of a tap.
Tap just barely that yellow there in the rings.
It punches the blue rock in solidly and just a biter for the yellow. But it does start to get a little congestion out in front. And
as Baxter says, not for long.
Not for long, that is for sure. Clean that up, center guard left in place.
Yeah, punches nice that blue over, and now it covers that one that's right on the button there in the 12-foot area to lie two.
So she's looking to push that blue back to the tee line would be the call, I think. I think she's looking ahead and thinking if she can get the blue just back behind the tee line and behind cover, she might be able to settle something down in there on the freeze. But Team Arsenal may have something to say about that.
Saw Elsa Noss there. She's going to time this one. She's the one that's completely in the black jacket. And that's Prue there in the gray t-shirt. There they pick that one out. Slide that blue one. Will it have enough juice to get out? Nope, we'll stay back 12.
And predictably, we're looking for appeal here. Great view of the slide from the...
Yeah, the technique is pretty... Christina Black. Picks it out. Shooter goes to the wings and out.
Oh, we're calling timeout here.
Timeout, so we'll get a chance to see the mayor of Lower Sackville, self-proclaimed mayor of Lower Sackville and the king of one-liners and the man who could really operate really good with 3 hours sleep, Mr. Brian Rafiers.
And he's making his way up along the edge of the ice, and we'll meet up with the team at the far end.
He's one of the ice makers, put in a lot of hours at the junior championships. And also guided the Dalhousie Tigers curling teams to silver medals last year at the AUS curling championships.
He's waiting for the other team to deliver stones so that he can get over there and chat with his team.
I'm sure he probably talked to every umpire, every player. Had probably something to say. There he is, the gentleman with the hat, the red hoodie. And we talked about the calm demeanor of this team, and sometimes your coach in sports, you build off of that, because the thing is, if you have a tense coach, all of a sudden you're in the situations like these and you sort of get more frazzled because the coach gets frazzled. You know about coaching, so I mean, the calm demeanor, sometimes it's really nice to have because you need that, as opposed to, of course, the fired up people. But he was joking me just off air before the broadcast this morning, and one of those times that he had a little team meeting, he just stood there and said nothing. And well, he said it worked.
Yeah, sometimes
it just said nothing.
Yeah, sometimes those timeouts are more about, taking a breath and making sure everybody's on the same page. And, if he didn't have to say anything, it meant that the message was already clear. Mm-hmm. And certainly at the junior level, I don't know if it would be so much at the... At this level, typically, but certainly at the junior level, sometimes it's about a confidence boost or a trying to get the team to reset and rethink and just sort of take a breath.
In the sport, there's infinite amount of situations, and sometimes the situation we've never seen before, what do? Front of the house a little bit cluttered, as you see.
That last rock just bumped a wee bit into their own yellow and spilled out to the sort of guarding the edge of the 12 foot there.
As Black makes her way down to talk to Marianne Arsenault, update on Sheed E. McDermott. Got three in the fourth, 4-1 as they play the fifth. Breen coming into today, 2-3. McDermott, perfect 5-0, looking to go 6-0 after the sixth draw.
McDermott's having a great week, guys.
Very well. It's like a great season, too. Like, he came in like second ranked in the standings, and right now.
And who was first ranked in the standings?
Joe Brothers was first ranked in the standings. Those, of course, are accumulated by bond spiels and points and accumulated on tours and things like that. So, of course, that gets you a bye so you don't have to go through the qualifier, which was in Windsor. The Battle of the Colleens, I like to call it, even though it's Nancy Delahunt's team on sheet C. Right now, Pinckney leading Jones as they play the fifth, 3-2. Still 2-1 is what they're saying with McAvoy over Brothers as they play the fourth. That's the last update we have on that one. Maybe.
Wow, what a great pick that was. Love to see those precise shots. That was really great.
Any changes, we'll let you know. I'm oohing on over that pick. I was looking at the other scores. Didn't get a chance to see it, so I believe you. But this Arsenal team just on. There's just no other word to say it. Get a lead, hard to get back.
This looks like it's staying out a little longer than they expected. Sweepers are at the ready, though. They might just punch up their own yellow. Reorganizes things, at least.
We'll push one of those yellows out to the wings and towards the side. So I'd like to, once again, as this team out of the Dartmouth Curling Club of Marianne Arsenault and
she comes sailing down the ice, ready to throw her first in this end.
And she's only hit hammer here in this game once, but boy, should he ever take advantage of a four spot, and that was in the first in. And we've had blanks 2, 3, 4.
I'm just looking over at the Jones-Pinckney game, and looking at the sweeping style of Kim Kelly, and wow, she is such a great sweeper. The mechanics that she has, she's getting some great pressure on that broom, and something I'd like to transition down to some of the junior players that we have.
Well, that's it. You get a chance to, like, up here, you can get a chance to see things, and, you know, the learning never stops in a sport.
That's for sure, especially when they keep changing the rules.
Yeah, for sure. It's a free guard zone. Three rock free guard zone, and then four, now five. And
there's a well-placed guard out in front. Arsenault looking for the steal here. Sitting two currently.
Yeah, they got that one right on the lid, and it is protected along the center line. Lattisera out here to have a little tickety-boo at that one.
That's the right weight in the distance of that guard. I wonder if she can come around and just give it a little kiss backwards.
Already talking to her teammates there, Harnish and Noss, what she's going to play, be on the same page.
Yep, that's so very important. You want your sweepers to know what the plan is so that they can be at the ready. And of course, she would look to them for confirmation of what they expect the weight to be and if this path is slow or fast or what have you.
Let's see just a little bit of that blow in there. That's the camera down ice level.
Here comes Isabel. Nice clean release.
And as she rely on her sweepers of Noss and Harnish.
And of course, the maid is calling the line in the house. She'd just like to paper that guard if she can. Just sneak by.
Oh, she can't.
Just needed another inch of ice, I'd say. Looks like she had great weight.
Yeah, path's starting to get a little bit to be the problem here as things start to clutter up in front.
And Arsinoe is looking to put another guard out in front, maybe a little to the left of the one she delivered last time, as I'm looking at it. A little to the left as we see it on camera here. And that'll pretty much plug up the house. The won't leave a lot of easy shots for the Leather Sword team.
Probably midway between the hog line and just the edge of that 12. Put it here and right along the center line and really close things up and make ports very small here.
And where the ice isn't curling, the only opportunity that would still be open would be a raise on a yellow, I think, in terms of trying to score.
Yep.
This will be over and off. As soon as it's over the hog line, they'll come off so that it'll stay out as far as possible.
Yeah, right in line with that one that's...
There might still be a port there.
Well, with it being a long one, they have a lot of room to come around, but...
You see the skip and mate taking a good look at it. Electing the hit, it looks like. It would be a lightweight hit, I would think, like a hackweight hit. But she'll have a hard time... You'd have a hard time sticking around. So she's looking to play a draw up two and possibly punch back that blue a little bit to count. I think that would be the ideal at this point.
That lonely blue-handled stone in the back just hanging on the 12-foot area. Nobody thought was paying much attention to it. It felt like, it was... It was at its own party that it decided to throw, and nobody showed up. Well, it could be a bit of a help here.
It could be.
Or hinder if you're a lot of surf fans. So.
That's right. Those little old biters can come back to bite you, that's for sure. Trying to make this one curl, but I'm afraid it's not going to curl enough.
It won't. Pushes over. So now a steal of two. For Arsenal. So, started the game off of a bang and ends it pretty well with a good bang too there. With a steal of two and in number five to take a 6-0 lead over this young Isabel Ladasur team out of the Lakeshore Curling Club. And of course, Marianne Arsenal out of the Dartmouth Curling Club up 6-0. So, bam, pretty well what we saw there in that first inning was pretty well sort of been the telltale story of this one. The Marcino of Hammer got four in the first and then Ladasur blanks and a steal here in two. So
yeah. And both teams, I think, are playing very well. It's just player-to-player percentages are higher, more precise by the Arsenal team, as you would expect with the experience and the successes they've had in the past. It's probably not a big surprise, but I think you'll see Isabel come out here with a positive approach and rejuvenated after the break.
Yep, fifth in break, 6-0. Arsenal over Ladasur here at draw number six of the 2018 Nova Scotia Scotties Tournament of Hearts here on Bell 5 TV 1. And we'll be back in about 4 minutes with the second half of this one. And there is Marianne Arsenault, who is sitting pretty right now in the lead, 6-0, as we play in number six, in draw number six. A Friday morning brought to you by the number six. 6-0, as we play the sixth in. Jen Kroos. My name is Dan Hobson, and joining us is Pam Sullivan, the Bell 5 TV1 crew here at the Nova Scotia Scotties Tournament of Hearts. Arsenault came in today 4-1, second place in the standings, hoping to improve to 5-1. And pretty well going to be in defensive mode. We've seen that since that opening four. In the first end, blanks by Lattisler in the second, third, and the fourth. Arsenault stole the first steal of the game in 5-2. And that's pretty well been the scoring information if you're just joining us here on a Friday morning here in Atlantic Canada. Just past 9 o'clock, actually 20 minutes past 9 o'clock. Getting a chance to get you all up to date on what you missed if you just joined us. And pretty well defense mode, maybe the plan the rest of the way. Once again, Arsenault's first stone goes into the house, ignored by Lattisler. She puts the guard up. This time, they'll just throw this one through. So once again, Lattisler will probably ask to put another guard up. Pinckney starting to break away there from Jones. It is 5-2 as they play in six, and McAvoy 3-1 over Brothers. So that's a big one there for McAvoy, Pam. She comes in 2-3. If she can get that one to 3-3, she evens her record at Brothers. But based upon what McDermott and Arsenault do, you know, that could be all of a sudden one of those teams with those three losses jumps back in again. So that's a big one there on sheet B.
Absolutely.
Right now, Brothers came in at 3-2. And all of a sudden, if that, if what it is now is what it is at the end of that one, we'll have a whole whack of teams that are at 3-3. Brothers would be 3-3. And thing with the Jones-Pinckney teams, one of those teams is going to win, so they're going to be 3-3. So
absolutely,
we're thinking tiebreakers may not be in the picture. The fate is in the hands of Brothers and McAvoy on sheet B.
And that looks like a good game, nice and close, and McAvoy must be really on their game today.
Yeah, of course, this is two draws today, so they'll have draw number 7 at 4 o'clock this afternoon. Short turnaround for them. The ladies say that's pretty well been our championships.
That's right. Gets them in shape for the ones who are going to the Scotties.
Yeah, two on Wednesday, one yesterday, and two again today. Gentlemen started off, of course, with their first draw on Tuesday, and they had two on Wednesday, and two yesterday, and two today. So, as I say, the round robin will come to an end tonight. And everything and the pitcher will be determined with what we got. So trying to come around. Lattisler comes up a couple steps now as they just skip by. I use the term just.
So they've got
inches, centimeters.
A bit of a double guard situation set up there, one behind the other, which can present a bit of a change for the Arsenault team in their approach. But as we saw by the early choices, she's going to continue to try to keep this clean and peel away.
Well, yeah, like the blanks were pretty well similar. Like there was still like, you know, one guard. Of course, Arsenault bring the first one into the house and then the guard, then they put the guard on the other side. So now why not double it? And
if you didn't get one, you were getting the other there.
Well, yeah, it's like, as you see, you get those.
You ice it tight and you know you're getting one or the other, that's for sure. these ladies are really, to pull off this many blanks, my goodness, they're very precise today. And yeah. I had the pleasure of speaking to the fifth for Team Arsenal, Carol McLean, at the break. And we were just chatting about how well Team Leidos Uru is doing. And, you know, they'll really be able to take this experience forward to them, both for the U18s, which they're playing in, as well as the Canada Games in March, both of those. And the Canada Games playdowns here in Nova Scotia. So I really think this will be a big boost for this team, and they're playing very well. The score doesn't necessarily show it, but they're putting up a good show here today.
Well, success doesn't come overnight. You're going to have to pay your dues, put in a lot of work, and you know some days you're going to have results that you know when you look at the score, another bad day at the office. Not really necessarily the case, as my broadcast colleague just mentioned.
And sport being what it is, not every day is your day. You know, we've. I chart some games as we see here next to us. Some other coaches do the same, and some days your team will throw, you know, less than 50%, and you certainly don't want those to be on the important games.
There's a country song. It says, sometimes you're the windshield, sometimes you're the bug.
That's bad. You don't want to be the bug. We got a few round table of laughter here out of that one.
Every once in a while, I'll come up with a zinger. 8 o'clock's when the creativity is good. 8 o'clock at night, creativity not so good.
Okay. A little war weary at that point, eh?
Yeah. You know, the funniest thing I think I ever did, ever commentating sport, was introducing the people that were doing the game. Mm-hmm. It was John Seitman, and I said that I was John Seitman and he was Dan Hobson. I got the names all mixed up. We got a good laugh out of that. It's like,
and John's a good guy. He would enjoy that.
Yeah, we had a good laugh about it for like 2 minutes. It's like, do you not know who you are? It's like, yeah.
So Ledesur chose to go wideside around that guard and just barely kissed it as they came by. So it came a little open, I think, and Arsenault. This is a tough hit, though, way out here in the wings with that really high guard. Whoosh,
Why?
Right by the guard, very nice. And a little roll open.
And I know it's starting to sound like a broken record, folks. If you join us here right off the top, once again, Arsenault lying two. This is the time that I wish I had a little bit more, you know, other language, you know, say it in like Spanish, French.
Well, I think from the players' perspectives, these two ladies' teams, you know, certainly the Ledesur team can't look at the scoreboard and have that on their mind when they're setting up every end. It's really critical, I think, for them to look at each end and each shot independent of the scoreboard and really just try to put their best set of shots forward and pick up the experience that they can from, you know, playing these teams that have played a lot more 10-end games than they have, that's for sure. This looks like it might be a little tight to the guard.
Yep, they're pretty well much on it.
The ice out on this side isn't quite as well known for the, you know, this is the first time we've really come down that side, so it's a little bit of a learning curve there, I think, at this point. I see Emily smiling as she chats to the skip and as she comes back to strategize on the final two shots of their end.
Might as well. Can't play tense, you might as well play loose and ignore the scoreboard.
It doesn't help to not be enjoying yourself,
yeah.
You know, it really doesn't. You're not going to play any better if you're angry with yourself.
Yeah. Team has lots of passion, as we see this Stone on its way here from Arsenault in six.
That's a great view of Marianne coming out of the hack and just how solid she is with her slide and great release.
Yeah, you've been pretty well impressed with them, you know, right, coming right out of the hack, pretty well square, no twist or anything. Like, watching Kristen McDermott, she has a little like twist, like right towards the end of her back foot. It looks fancy, but just makes you sort of think, you know, it may like do something in terms of the throw. But of course, if that's the way that you've learned and you've done it pretty well, you know, they start curling at a very young age and they continue to do it now, you know, if it ain't broken, don't fix it. But as you say, you like how steady they are.
Yeah, if you, from my perspective, yeah. I can't help, I'm an engineer, and so I can't help but look at the mechanics of things and understand the momentum and the weight transfers and all that sort of thing. And to me, the less activity you're doing other than straight onto that broom, the better off you're going to be.
A curler, an engineer, no. Not in this sport, no.
But it's...
it's like half of them are in it.
Yeah. The thing is, though, you know, all of these women's teams would be constantly working at and tweaking their slides and their deliveries. Because before you know it, you've picked up a bad habit, no matter who you are.
Yeah.
So a lot more of the teams, I think, are using video and photographic analysis to help. And, you know, it's a constant revisiting of your work, for sure.
It's just like hitters getting in the batter's box. They have to keep tweaking things.
Absolutely.
And then all of a sudden they do something, that they make a slight adjustment and it works. But it may just work for that game alone, and it may be more of a hinder. So
it's a nice draw weight shot.
Yeah, they're very close to the button, the shot rock in the meantime.
And it's mostly buried. I think you might see a sliver of that from the other end. Black and Arsenault looking at it, trying to just decide which way they want to handle that situation.
Fifth in break on sheet B, McAvoy leading 3-2.
I see over on sheet E that Breen has reduced the lead a little bit with McDermott up 4-3. Over Breen.
Yeah, you know, we get into the closing stages, you know, they're probably doing a little bit of scoreboard watching.
Yes, you get that scoreboard management. Some teams are very focused on trying to get the hammer in the even ends as you get towards the end of the game.
Right now, so far, some of the teams looking up and seeing McDermott and Arsenault leading and thinking and seeing that maybe some of their playoff hopes getting a little bit away. But as I said, with the McAvoy brothers game, that's a big one, because said they go 3-3, almost everybody's back in the hunt. Brothers comes away of winning that one, should be sitting at 4-2, and all of a sudden there's your three top teams, but of course there's still one draw left, but definitely getting away from the other teams.
So it looks to me like once Marianne Arsenault got to the far end, she had a change of plans. Initially, I think she was looking to punch that yellow off of the 4-foot, and now she's got a guard coming in, looking to hold, force a point have the Dorser take a point. Makes it really hard to come in for a second point at this, with the way things are set up now.
Yep, they've got their thinking hats, Prue and Latticeur. Seeing that there's nothing there, they're going to take a little bit more ice and extra housekeeping done there by Prue.
Yep, you don't want any picks at that point, that's for sure.
Now this is when you get into like the second half and the later stages, of course, when things, of course, beyond your control, like picks, ice conditions, sliding path wearing down, a little less pebble. Any of those things that you gotta be, you know, weary of.
So this is the last rock in this end, and if Isabel can get a little nibble on that forefoot, she needs just a piece of it. The blue is just kissing the forefoot. So she just needs a bit of the forefoot here. We haven't been down here on this part of the ice yet. It's out quite a ways. Not a lot of sweeping has been out here, so the weight may be a little bit of a surprise at this late stage of the game.
Takes off, says across that hog line, starts to come over. Can it come over in time? Nope, it's going to sail towards the back, so it's just a single point here for Lattisure.
That was a tough old draw to try to find the piece of the forefoot with the guards where they were, that's for sure.
6-1, Arsenault has a hammer in 7.
And Lattisure is on the board and gets a change of pace. Her strategy can switch up now. So I'm sure she'll enjoy that difference.
Yep, game's pretty well 3 blanks and a steal, besides the 4-spot put by Arsenault up in end number 1. That's all we've had going on here, so... Now, get on the board, and of course you have to give up the hammer being down by 5, but strategy still hasn't really changed for either team. You know, now, of course, pretty well stones are going to be in play here for Lattisure and Arsenault. Stones are not my friends. I don't want them around, but we'll see how it goes. That's how the plan is, but of course sometimes
that's right.
The plan doesn't go as you think it does mentally, as it does actually happening. So
yeah, what you picture in your mind is a little harder to deliver at times, that's for sure. But they're looking for a center guard here. That'll be a different scenario than we've seen in the prior ends, just because of the change of hammer. And we're getting a nice tight guard in there. That's a great location. And of course, that can't not be removed because of our 4-rock rule. Yeah. I expect they'll go...
In the house with this next one.
I expect. I didn't see a great indication, though, from the skipper down there, so she could be throwing a guard up here. I think they're eyeing a tip shot here.
Yeah, this is, they can pretty well split it towards the wings. They could just can't remove it.
They're closer to nose, so it's going to really depend upon the weight. Isabel is trying to get it out the back door. Marianne is joining her. And so that gets replaced.
Yes.
It was right back where it came from. And where it was a nose hit, it's nice and easy to figure out. There's no question where it was. And that is the risk with the tick shot. It's a very difficult shot because it's such a precise combination of weight and ice. And... But, I mean, certainly this is the time, if you're the Arsenault team, this is the time to do it.
Very much. Great point. Because you may get to a time where you need to do that, and now, you know, may not get the result that you wanted there in that one, but at least you can put it in the memory bank and say, well, maybe I could just take a little bit off of it next time and maybe, you know, just maybe try to go for a split. Of course, one of the best at that tick shot, Lisa Wiggle of the Holman team. She just... Don't see her miss too many of them. And again, it is not an easy shot, as we have seen.
So we're looking for the open draw here. So they're going to go to the left-hand side on your screen. With Jen Krause delivering that rock.
And really with, of course, the attempted tick, they last in, of course, what they did was they put one in the house, and then their next one they threw it through, so this works out to be pretty well the opposite of it. They'll put the second one into the rings with, the, of course, that tick one being removed as a result of the free guard zone, so pretty well the same scenario.
It is. Now with hammer, of course, there's your second point.
Yeah.
That's what Team Arsenault is thinking, because in all likelihood, the Lattisure team will ignore that rock and try to go in behind cover, and that rock will tend to be ignored throughout the rest of this end, I suspect, until the at the very end, and Arsenault will hope to include it in their score. That's what it says in the textbook, anyway.
How big is that book?
I don't even think there is a book.
Well, if there was, I imagine probably it'd have to be almost like the size of bed and probably three or four people would have to carry it around. And
I suspect with all the stats that they have, somebody has put together the most likely to succeed set of shots somewhere.
Noss and Prue coming around those two yellows out front.
So they really need this to bury.
Trying to.
Stays open for a second shot, I think. And of course, Marianne Arsenault is going to go for the hit and roll to cover up her other blue stone, I think would probably be the preference here. But simply to remove this is the number one goal. Oh, no, she's going out in front. I like this. I think these two shots are the most dangerous to her at this point.
Yeah.
She needs access to that center section to score, and hopefully to score her two.
Get rid of that first guard that you see. Oh, they'll bump the yellow out, so can they push that blue one over enough? Not quite.
Yeah, the blue one is, that provides a pretty decent cover.
I could see that their game plan, of course, when they didn't have Hammer versus Hammer, you know, they were pretty well in peel mode once they got that 4-1, and you know, had Lattister had the Hammer a lot for the majority of this game, and they got the single point in 6, and you can see that even the change of gameplay, they're still seem to be making their shots. So.
Yeah. She's looking for this guard just to make it over the hog line. It looks like the girls are working pretty hard at this.
And now Lattister will take over there from
just
Noss.
Not quite enough on that rock. It's didn't quite make it over the hog line. And I mean, at this part of the game, we are looking at the seventh end, and this center section has been used quite a bit. There's been a lot of sweeping on there. It's possible the ice, some of the pebble gets worn down. You get a few patchy spots here and there, and it's possible that has come into play a bit on that last stone.
Jennifer Baxter.
Look at the sweeper go on that. What great form.
Yep.
Nice.
Bumps it out.
Bump out the back door to sit two.
Lattister gonna go say, well, I'm not having much luck on this side of the sheet. I'll just go over here and see what I can generate.
Little
Emily
change.
Prue.
Yeah, they certainly wouldn't want to guard up that blue stone, that's for sure.
They have a yellow one out front that they can come around, and Harnish and Noss working on it. A yellow one coming up on them, as you see.
Nice and close there.
Yeah.
Will it finish enough to hide?
Can it dig it, get over some more? It comes to a rest.
I mean, you couldn't really have gone much closer to that yellow rock to pass by. I mean, they're really having a hard time getting enough curl to bury these. Who do we have in the hack here? Christina Black, looking to get rid of some yellow stones here.
Light brushing there from Jennifer Baxter. Now turns it up a gear.
Spills her shooter away from.
Nice work by Baxter to get it out the rest of the way. Not taking any chances. And brushes it out and out of play. Talked about me, you know, the fatigue level maybe kicking in. This has been like a couple of, you know, hard weeks there for this team. They were at the junior championships, you know that, and you know, and now here they are here. So that's a lot of curling in a short amount of time.
It is, and it's a tough time of year, I would think, to take a week off of school. These young ladies would have exams coming up very shortly, I would think, and you know, it's certainly it's good it's not their grade 12 year, because that would make it, I think, just that much more difficult to take the time off. Now, just I just was watching a stone delivered over on Sheet C, and I'm not sure who threw the rock, but I see that they had a hog stone over there as well, between Pinky and Giles. And, you know, it's these things can happen at this point in the game, that's for sure.
Nice little two-step there by Crows. Which one do I go after? Which one is like...
It's hard. You only know after the wrong, after like, one stops.
Like, I've only got two arms and one brush. I can't have, can't do both of them at the same time.
Yeah, these gals have to be light on their feet at times, and that experience really kicks in, so they, you know, they can figure out which one to do more quickly, that's for sure.
We're into Skip Rocks here at 7. Isabel Lattiser out of Lakeshore Curling Club. Difference in this one was Arsenault had hammered one, got four, and she's been pretty well chasing down the veteran curler out of the Dartmouth Curling Club. Covers up that yellow one there.
Covers up nicely.
Yeah.
And that yellow one is in fact shot rock right now. It's a little difficult to see with the view you have on your screen, but the yellow one is shot rock, so that's got to be dealt with by this Arsenal team.
Give everybody sort of the Coles Notes versions of what's going on in the other sheets. McDermott still leading Breen 4-3. And McAvoy still leading Brothers 3-2. And Jones fighting her way back, but it's 5-4 Pinckney over Jones as they play the seventh over there.
Our shot. Sweepers at the ready on and off, which is a great sign. This rock needs to do some curling. Trying to get in there to pick out yellow, is it?
Oh, just,
nice shot.
Yep.
Push it out of scoring zone. As Arsenault has two rocks that are closer than that yellow one. And that was, boy, oh boy, that was.
Yeah, well, you were looking at it, it's like, and sometimes, of course, in amazement, it's like, uh-oh, this could be it.
It just curled over
right
at the right
moment. Yeah, and it just, you know. And then, of course, if you were probably to, you know, talk to them after the game about that, oh, yeah, that was no worries. That was fine. That's how I planned it.
That's right.
See, that's the you guys say about me playing the sport is I'd be just chewing my nails like. I mean,
well, on the
on a lot of shots.
When you're out there playing, in some ways as a spectator, it's more stressful than when you're playing, because you're out of breath half the time and just trying to catch up. So, I find when I'm coaching, it's much more dramatic of a situation than when I'm actually on the ice playing. And she's looking to come in behind cover. That looks like it's going to bury quite nicely there, right? Pretty much where it was a minute ago.
Harnish with the finish puts it right there. Shot rock for the meantime, belonging to Lattiser out of the Lakeshore Curling Club.
And I would think that's very much available in the same way that it was on the last shot, but that does not make it an easy shot.
Just want to follow up on you, but you were talking about your point. Of course, you coaching. Do you also sometimes wish, man, two timeouts are just not enough?
Well, there are times like that. You know. But sometimes, particularly at the junior level, by the time the timeout is called, you really can't help.
Yeah.
So.
Because it must be like sort of different, you know, as you say, watching versus playing and being coach, you know, seeing your players out there. And
it's easier to
and you're not as like interactive as, like as some coaches in other sports, because you can't whisper in their ear over like they do like sidelines in like football and stuff. Is
oh beautiful.
They punch that out once again.
That was great. No, you can't, and it's both good and bad. You know, I think it's great. The kids, from the junior perspective, if they're out there, they can make their decisions and learn as opposed to being guided the whole time.
Well, we have a final. We're done here as Arsenal will improve her record to 5-1, and Ladasur will drop to 0-6. So a big win and a winning streak kept alive at 5 there for the Arsenal foursome. And you know, pretty well, if it was a prize fight here, Pam, it was, you know, done in the first round, that four spot there by Arsenal with Hammer, and that's just real tough to recover.
It really is, especially when Team Arsenal is playing so precisely and so strongly. And but a big round of applause to the young ladies on Team Ladasur. I think they all played very well today, and they'll take this experience forward, and it'll really give them some momentum in the U18s and the Canada Winter Game playdowns that are coming up in March.
As you see, they got a 2 there with the hammer, so she only had the hammer 2 times in this game and took advantage of it, a 4 spot and 1 to start, and a 2 spot here at the end. So you could just give your final thoughts on this one on before we wrap up, Pam.
Well, I think it's a great game for Marianne Arsenault and her team. I think they're moving ahead with great momentum as they wind up this week, and certainly they'll be carrying that energy and precision shot-making into the final games.
So as you see, 8-1 the final score. The Marianne Arsenault foursome out of the Dartmouth Curling Club, Jennifer Krause, Jennifer Baxter, Crusader Black, Marianne Arsenault, their coach Peter Corkum, and Carol McLean over the Team Ladasur, Elsa Noss, Kayla Harnish, Emily Pruitt, Isabel Ladasur, and Brian Rayfew. So, for my broadcast colleague, Pam Sullivan, thanks once again.
Thank you.
We're signing off from now here from Draw 6 of the Nova Scotia Scotties Tour of Our Hearts. For Pam Sullivan, my name's Dan Hobson. So long. Thank you for watching Bell 5 TV1's coverage of the Nova Scotia Scotties Tournament of Hearts.